died. You said in 3 days you would rise. You did. You're alive. You rule. You reign. You said you're coming back again. I know you will. All the earth sing your praises.
You rule, you reign,
reading continuously the story. We tell the story of Jesus, as the old hymn says, tell me the story of Jesus. The story of Jesus is not just a story, it is a true story. We use the word story very lightly. But what Jesus did, how he lived, how he died, for what he died, how he rose again, that changes everything about our lives. Everything about our lives. Because he lived, because he died, because he rose again, because he reigns on high, nothing is the same. Because of that, we have hope today. How many of you believe that? And Paul says, that's why I can do all things through Christ. And when he says through Christ, he's talking about the Christ who lived, who died, who rose again, and who rules and reigns on high. He's talking about the risen, reigning Christ. And he says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's what this song says. Let's sing it out with faith. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You really believe that? All things. We have a powerful Christ who's strengthening us. All of us need His strength, and He is there to provide it for us. Oh, let's just continue to praise Him, worship Him, and receive His strength. crash, love that's never fade. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of the saved, the hope of nations. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light in. may Jesus be glorified. May Jesus be
Lamb and the word of our testimony. Conquered sin and sickness, death, the grave itself, and all of evil, so that there is great hope for us today. Not only hope, but great certainty, assurance that we will overcome. Oh, let's just praise Jesus. Only He could have done something like this. Only He could have died for our sin and made sure our sin is removed out of the picture, washed clean, white as snow, righteous before the sight of God. Only He could have removed the curse that was upon us and given us blessing. Only He could have overcome death itself. Jesus alone is worthy of our praise. We worship You, Jesus. We thank You, Jesus. For today, You are seated at the right hand of God, far above all principality and power, might and dominion. Your name is greater than any other name. And it's a privilege and honor for us to worship You, Jesus. We thank You, Jesus, that You are present in our midst today. Your presence is here. The risen Lord Jesus is here right now. Help us to realize that. Help us to experience Your presence. Even as this service proceeds, manifest Your presence in a greater, stronger manner, we pray. Continue to minister to Your people, we pray. Draw them closer to You, we pray. Enlighten us, thrill us. Give us great hope and encouragement, we pray. Accomplish Your plans and purposes for Your glory. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. You may be seated.
We're going to partake of the Holy Communion this morning. This is a practice established by the Lord Jesus Himself, says the great Apostle Paul. Why? He says, so that we may remember Him and what He has done for us on the cross of Calvary. So this morning as we partake of this, we need to remember what happened on the cross of Calvary, the one who died there, who He is the Son of God. Why should the Son of God, the Holy One, die on the cross that horrible death? It is because it is as a sacrifice for our sins He died. God gave Him as a sacrifice. so that our sins may be washed out, so that we may be made righteous. And all of these things are the central beliefs of the Christian faith. In order to remember this, this ordinance has been established. So we observed this morning, and I pray, and I will say to you today that it must be done in a very meaningful way. And those of us who have received Jesus as Lord and Savior and understand this work of redemption and appreciate it by experiencing it are the ones who can really partake of it meaningfully. So let us partake of it meaningfully today. First communion will be served. After everyone is served, we will all stand up and together we will observe communion. Until such time, please keep the wafer and the wine with you and wait until I ask everyone to stand, please. Shall we all bow our heads in prayer? Loving Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus we come. Thank you, Lord, for this great sacrifice of your Son on the cross of Calvary for our sins, which has brought us to you, changed everything about us. All things are today available to us from the grace and the mercy and the love of God because of this great sacrifice on the cross of Calvary. And this bread and this wine represents the body and the blood, that body that was broken, the blood that was shed for our sakes, and all that comes to us through it. And today we remember it and we appreciate it. Our hearts glory in nothing but the cross of Calvary. We rejoice over what God has done for us. We give thanks for the great love of God as we partake of it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Mountains that you climb, a war within the soul, for every step you gave. Remember when the winds of sorrow strike you down, to leave you hopeless and afraid. Proof of battle is the wound that build you strong for the journey that you make. There's not a victory without a fight, and there's not a sunrise without a night. There's not a purchase without a cost. Without a cause, no greater anguish ever came upon a man than when the Son of Glory died. Sins of all of us were nails that pierced his hands. The act of sacrifice, the love within the price. His crown was fashioned from his suffering and travail. Shone like the sun when he rose. He showed his triumph even when all hope was lost. He carried out a plan so that every man would know. If there's not a victory without a fight. There's not a sunrise without a night. There's not a purchase without a cross. There's not a crown without the cross. God will guide you when you cling to His hand. His strength will find you, help you learn how to stand, to persevere to the end. There's not a victory without a fight. Oh, there's not a sunrise without a night. There's not a purchase without a cause. There's not a crown without a cross. There's not a crown without a cross.
Shall we all stand together for a minute, please? For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is My body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of Me. Now you may partake of the bread." In the same manner, He also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in My blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me. Now you may partake of the cup." Let's take a moment to give thanks to God for all that He has done for us and all that it means to us today. Let's lift up our hearts to Him and give Him thanks. Thank you, Father. Oh, we worship you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you, Jesus. Father, we stand before you today with a thankful heart for all that you have done for us and all that the cross of Jesus Christ means for us today. You have done the utmost. You have gone all the way, given everything, even your own Son. How will you not give us all other things freely, your word says, and we believe it. We believe in your love, your great love for us that will do anything for us. We thank you and we are thankful for every favor, every grace, every mercy that is shown to us, O God. And for this new life, new possibilities, we thank you. For this new nature, for this new future that you have given to us, we thank you, Father, and we rejoice in you. We give ourselves to you, to live for you, and to glorify you in this life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated, and while you sing the song a little bit more, return the cups, please. Sing the song with Jonathan as he sings, and return the cups.
God will guide you when you cling to His hand. His strength will find you, help you learn how to stand, to persevere to the end. There's not a without a fight. Oh, there's not a sunrise without a night. There's not a purchase without a cost. There's not a crown without a cross. There's not a crown without a cross. There's not a crown without a cross.
Let's continue to worship God by giving our tithes and offerings. Let's get our offerings ready. As you're doing that, let me remind you that apart from cash, you may give through check, money order, demand draft in favor of Victory Christian Foundation. As you see up there, you can also give online through our website, revsam.org. You can also give through all kinds of cards. We have card swiping machines in the back in the bookstall right now. They'll remain there at the end of the service for your convenience. Let's all say this before we give our offering. Let's say this. Jesus said, give, and it shall be given back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men pour into your bosom. I believe what Jesus said. Lord, you are my source. I look up to you. I depend on you. I honor you, so I give to you. Amen. As you're giving your offering, let me take this opportunity to welcome newcomers in our midst. If you are here for the first time in our church, would you please raise your hand? If you're here for the first time, please raise your hand. We just want to give you a little brochure. If you just keep your hand raised, they'll bring it to your seat right now, wherever you're seated. If you just look inside that brochure, you'll find a white card. We'd like you to fill that out with your name and other details after the end of this service. Please take that white card outside to the newcomer's desk in our bookstall. Hand it over to them. They'll give you a free CD and a free magazine. There's a lot of good sermons and articles that'll be useful for you. Tamil magazine. The sermons will be in English and Tamil. On behalf of Pastor Sam and the entire AFT family, I take this opportunity to welcome you to our church, and we hope that you will continue to come and experience for yourself the wonderful things that God is doing in and through our church. Now, for an important announcement, from this Sunday evening onwards, from today evening onwards, the Sunday evening service timing has changed from 6:30 p.m. to 6 p.m. 30 minutes earlier, we will start. Thank you.
Please turn with me to John, the Gospel of John, chapter 6. I've been teaching about work. First, we talked about how God designed man in such a way that he must work. Work is built into man, part of his nature. He is made like God, therefore he must work. We showed you why God designed man for work, so that he may use the talents and abilities that God has given him and produce excellent stuff, the things that God wants him to produce, and by it bring glory to God so that people may see the glory of God through that and God's plans and purposes may be fulfilled for this world through that. That is why work was given. We saw how sin came in and ruined this work that was supposed to bring such satisfaction and joy and fulfillment, a sense of fulfillment. It was all ruined, and work became a very difficult thing. It became a toil. And we looked at how sin affected us, affected the whole area of work, this whole aspect of work. And then we began to talk about how redemption in and through Jesus Christ deals with our sin and the curse that came upon mankind. And one of the curses that came upon mankind was that work was cursed. The work of their hands was cursed. And how that the cross of Calvary has dealt with it and has made a difference in it, so that when we work today as redeemed people, what kind of changes can we see in attitude and in practice as people work? That's what we're talking about right now. Today, we went to the Old Testament and the New Testament to show that, how the redeemed people work. In the Old Testament, even the people of God, the people of Israel were redeemed people in a way. So even through them, it is demonstrated. And in the New Testament, certainly after Jesus came, we can see it in the church, in practice, and so on. I want to go to John's Gospel, chapter 6. I want to take a passage from what Jesus said and show you what work means under redemption. John chapter 6, let me read to you verse 27, the first part. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life. I want to stop there. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life. Now, we have heard or seen many sayings about work. I see sayings put up in places where people have put it up as work is worship. Work is divine or God or something like that. I saw in one place it said labor is life. Labor is life. Now, labor is life means that without labor, there cannot be a life. That's what they mean. We work, we labor, because it is through work we provide food, we provide a house, we provide clothes, we provide education, we provide everything that our family needs and so on. So without work, there cannot be life. That is what that saying means. In some way it is true, but when you read the words of Jesus here in verse 27, here he says, do not labor for the food which perishes. Do not labor for the food that perishes. Not only talking about food, for anything that perishes, anything that is of temporal value. But only labor for the food which endures to everlasting life. Only keep in mind or look beyond as you work, look beyond that which is temporal to the things that are of eternal value and work only for those things. Don't be just working for temporal things, but work for things which have eternal value. That's another way that you can put this verse. Just keep that in mind. Do not work for things that have only temporal value. Work for things that have eternal value or that are of eternal value. Now, this seems like a statement that is exactly contrary to this saying that some people have put up saying labor is life, that labor is everything, that without labor you cannot have a life, you can't provide food and other things that we need. So basically you work to provide that and that's what life is all about. But the Bible says no, don't work for the things that are temporal like food, house, car, whatever, you know, temporal things. But work for things that have eternal value. It seems like it is contradicting this idea. And it is not an ordinary contradiction, because you and I know that in order to provide food, we got to work. In order to pay our rent, we got to work. Anybody in the world, anybody with any sense, they will say, yeah, I got to work to provide. And without work, you cannot provide anything. So how can you say don't work for things that are temporal value and work only for those things that are of eternal value? We are working for things that are of temporal value to provide things like food that perishes today. You eat this afternoon, again you're hungry tonight. Where did the food go? It perished. It went into your body and disappeared somewhere. You're again all over, once again you are hungry, you see. Food that perishes. And there are so many things that perish today in this world. And it's a very clear thing that we work basically for this temporal stuff in this world. Then how can the Bible say, do not work for things that have only temporal value, but only work for things that are eternal? Now, whenever you see a real problematic verse like this, That seems like unreasonable. It seems like it's against human logic. Seems like labor is life is a decent statement. You got to work to provide. You got to work to pay your rent. You got to work to, meet every need. How come the Bible is saying don't work for temporal needs? Whenever you find a statement like that from the Bible, please remember, you need to dig in and look at it, because there is a truth there, a life-transforming truth there that is hidden in it. It is not contradicting anything. It is not a problem at all. There is something for us to understand, dig out and understand and benefit from. That's the way I look at scriptures. Many statements like this are there in the scriptures, and I believe that this is one such statement. So we're going to look at it. What does it mean to say, do not labor for things that have only temporal value, but labor only for the things that have eternal value? This is what Jesus is saying. What should I work for? Don't work for food. Don't work for anything else, but work for only those things that have eternal value. What did he mean by that? Now, in order to understand this passage, you need to understand the context of this passage. The context is that Jesus just got through feeding 5,000 people. They say maybe 15 to 20,000 people ate. In those days, they did not count the women and children. Now, Jesus doesn't believe in this kind of culture. The Bible sometimes simply mentions it because that was the culture of the time. The Bible doesn't approve it. The Bible is actually teaching against all of this. You know, if you read 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 7, it says, give the honor that is due to the wife. So the Bible doesn't have any problem in giving the honor to the woman in the family, you know. Giving honor means she is counted as a number. In that culture, in the time of writing of the New Testament, in that culture, women were not even counted. That's not a way to honor women. But the Bible says, Peter writes, give the honor that is due to the woman. Verse 7 in chapter 3 of 1 Peter. Peter says that. So Bible is well advanced. Bible didn't speak about these things after the feminist movement came. We don't really need the feminist movement. We have the Bible. And the Bible talks about the liberty and the freedom that belongs to every woman under God as a creation of God. There's no problem. Even children were not counted in those days. Not even respected as anything. The women and children not counted as a number at all. Not even taken into account. Can you believe that culture? But Jesus says, do not forbid the children from coming to me. He put a child in the midst of the disciples and said, unless you become like one of these, you will never even enter into the kingdom of God. He extolled the virtues of children, how innocent they are and how they believe and how they have simple faith and so on. So he used it as an example. You know, he didn't put down children, you know. He didn't say, just take them away from me, they're a nuisance. He said, don't forbid them. Allow them to come to me. So in Bible, you see some culture of the day in which it was written, but you also see that culture is not approved by the Bible teaching, all right? The Bible teaches exactly the opposite. So 10, 15, 20,000 people ate maybe. What did they eat? Jesus took 5 loaves and two fish and multiplied it to food for these thousands of people. Now, these people ate and were satisfied, and 12 baskets were left over, as you know. And next day, the news is spreading everywhere. So they're talking, well, today it's fish meal. Tomorrow it must be chicken, I think. Where is he having his meeting? Now, I know some preachers read this, and they are saying in every meeting they have, they serve food also. Because Jesus didn't have a meeting without any food, one preacher said. He always served food when he had meeting. That's all they understand from this passage, you know. But John chapter 6 is not about how when you have meeting you need to serve food. I don't serve any food here, you know. I don't think anybody will eat if I served food here. The thing is, this is not about how if you had a meeting you had to serve food. No, that's not the point. Don't miss the point. Jesus was making a point here. Actually, John writing this story makes a point. You know, John says in John in the same gospel in chapter 20, he says, there are many things to write. I have not written it. You know, books cannot contain all that can be said about what Jesus did during his lifetime. There are so many things to say, but I have chosen these things and I put them here in my gospel, he says, so that you may believe. The purpose of his writing is that so that we may believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he is the Savior, and so on. So with the purpose he's writing, and all the miracles are written with a it's not to state that a miracle happened. There is a meaning behind the miracles. That's the way John writes it. It's different from the other three gospels. They are in the Bible colleges and all, the other three gospels are taught together. They are called synoptic gospels because most of the stories are the same, you know, same narrative there in the three gospels, basically. Only a few differences. But here in the Gospel of John, it is entirely different, and therefore it is a different gospel. It is always taught separately. And every miracle here mentioned here is handpicked by John in order to demonstrate a particular truth, to reveal something about Jesus and so on. So, for example, the turning of the water into wine, which was the first miracle that Jesus did. When he tells the story, at the end of the story, in verse 11 of chapter 2, he says, this was the first miracle that Jesus did, and he did it in Cana of Galilee, and manifested forth his miracle in this, his glory in this way. He manifested his glory through this first miracle in this way. So that is why he turned the water into wine. Jesus didn't turn the water into wine just to show that he can do some magic, you know. I saw the other day some guy turning mineral water into wine, you know. And people are drinking and saying, yeah, it's wine, it's sweet, it's wine. But there is no message there, you know. There is no message about Jesus, about salvation, about the love of God or anything like that. All that I learned by looking at the video is that if I had a problem, I must contact this guy. This is a great guy. He can turn water into wine. My God, he took the mineral water and turned it into wine. Somebody drank it and said, this is sweet. It's mineral water. I mean, it's wine. That's all I learned. We know that he's a great guy, very anointed, very powerful. That is all we understand. Jesus never did it because of that. Jesus did it to make a point, to show forth his glory. What is his glory? His glory is that when he took the water and turned it into wine, he took something that was colorless, odorless, and tasteless, and turned it into colorful. Something that is full of nice odor, and something that is full of wonderful taste, which is wine. There is a complete transformation, complete change. By doing this, he showed forth his glory. That means, just like he took the colorless, odorless, tasteless water and made it so wonderful, colorful, tasteful, and full of odor, he will take your life, which is often colorless, odorless, and tasteless, and turn it into something beautiful, wonderful, tasteful. He will make your life wonderful. That's the point he's trying to make. That is why Jesus came. And he will do it in abundant measure. That is why he filled the water jars that were used for washing the feet, because there was abundance of wine. Some people have a habit of taking Bible for their convenience. You know, one drunk came to me and said, did you know Jesus turned water into wine? I said, yeah, you will also say next that he told you to roll on the ground after drinking wine, you know. That's the point he is trying to make, you know, that it's all right to drink. Jesus turned water into wine. So everybody's using the Bible for their own convenience. No, Jesus turned water into wine so that you can see that he can take your drunken life and turn it into something beautiful and wonderful. You know, it is not to tell you to drink, but to tell you that he can completely turn you around, you know. And in the same way, this miracle, the feeding of the 5,000, after he fed the 5,000 with loaves and fish, they thought maybe tomorrow he's having some meeting there and he's also feeding people next day. So they started following him, and they came and saw he was not there, and somebody said he's gone across the lake there, and so they took boats and crossed over and came. And here he sees hundreds of people coming. And to them he says these words. Verse 27 is said to them when he saw them coming. He says, do not labor for the food which perishes. He says, man, you're trying so hard for something that stays in your stomach for just a few hours and then it's gone and you're hungry all over. Do not labor for something that has such a temporal value. You're working so hard, trying so hard to get something that is temporal. But labor for the food that endures to eternal life. Labor, work for something that has eternal value. Something that will last you forever. It'll come with you forever, he says. Now, we need to look at this and understand this. Now, the people there did not understand the point that he was trying to make. Why did he feed the 5,000 with bread and fish? Not to show that he fills his stomach. Filling the stomach is not a problem for God. He can do it 1,000 times over again. The point is not that I can fill the stomach. The point is I can fill the greatest needs of every human being and I can meet every need. So don't go after the things that satisfy you, like food and so on. Go after the person who is the source of meeting all your needs. He came to tell about himself. They totally missed the point. They got the food, they got the stomach filled, but they missed him. So they come searching for him. And now he continues in verse 35. Look at verse 35. Look at verse 35. He says, then they said to him, Jesus said to him, I am the bread of life. Now he's trying to give the meaning for what he did. The bread and the fish that he gave. He says, I am the bread of life. This is the point I tried to make to you guys, he says. But you missed the whole point. You were satisfied that your stomach were full. But I want to make this point. I am the bread of life. It's not about the bread that you ate. But I am giving a message to you that I am the bread of life, he says. He who comes to me shall never hunger. He who believes in me shall never thirst. In other words, if you eat this food, you're going to be hungry in just a few hours. And again, you'll be hungry. But I am here to talk about another food that when you eat, you will never be hungry. And when you drink that, you will never be thirsty. I'm talking about something spiritual, something wonderful, which is the thing that you need. And through that, only all the physical needs are also met. But you are missing the whole point. You are just staying with the physical, never going on to the real meaning of what I did, he says. If you eat what I give you, you'll never hunger. If you drink what I give you, you'll never thirst. But you never got my point, he says. I tried to make that point through my miracle, but you never got to. See, that's why miracles of Jesus were known in the Gospels as signs and wonders. Have you ever wondered what the sign is? Sign means that it's pointing to something. On the road you see a sign, it says Trichy, 320 kilometers. It means if you keep going like this, you will get to Trichy. It's a sign. It's a sign that if you go there, if you go this way, you'll reach there, right? Wonder, the word wonder simply means that when you see something like this happen, you begin to wonder what this is all about. They neither wondered, nor did they understand what the sign was about. They were satisfied. I think they went and slept. Did not even give any thought to it. Next day they got up and came for chicken and rice maybe. You know. Jesus says, you missed the whole point. This is about how I am the bread of life. If you eat the bread that I give you, you'll never hunger. Do you understand that point? Did you get my point? You ate and you were, see, a lot of people are like this, you know, they've come to get their physical needs met, and the next time you'll see them in church is next time when they're sick, you know. When you see them, you know they got a problem. And when you see them, they got a need. That's when they will come. They think Jesus is someone who just feeds or heals or just meets their need or something like that. But the miracles of Jesus made a point to them. Pointing to something greater. Certainly Jesus wants to feed. Certainly Jesus wants to heal and so on. But there is a greater point that he's trying to make and these people totally missed it. Now, we read 35, but then he continues. It's very interesting. Read verse 51. I'm not reading the whole passage. You may read it later on when you get home. But I'm just reading here and there just to make this point. I'm trying to convey to you what Jesus did this miracle for. Verse 51. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. See, he said, he said in verse 35 that I am the bread of life. If you eat what I give you, you'll never hunger again, right? Now he goes a little deeper. He says, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. Not only not hunger, but he will live forever. See, he's getting he wants them to catch the point. He says, and the bread I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. Now he has created a controversy now. Now he's going a little deeper. Sometimes I think he deliberately does these things because there is a group among the crowd sometimes of the Jews that don't believe, like the Pharisees and so on, the Sadducees and this kind of people that always want to resist him and give him trouble. So he sometimes aims at reaching them and shaking them up a little bit. So he does things in a different way. Remember when he healed the man born blind in chapter 9, he spits on the ground and makes clay and puts it on the eye of the guy, you know. And preachers have preached saying, well, the ground has some medicinal value, you know, when you spit on it and make clay with it and put it on somebody's eyes, they may get healed and so on. All these kinds of things were taught about that. But it's not so. You know why he did it? To upset the Jews. The Jews believed that on Sabbath day you cannot work. And somebody said, what do you mean can't work? They said, you cannot plow. And somebody said, what do you mean not plow? So they listed a number of things that amounts to plowing, you know. Suppose you want to move this from here to there, you cannot even drag it because you'll be plowing then, you know. Like this, they wrote a book which had silly explanations about what working is all about. That's what Pharisaical preaching is all about. That's why they never got a crowd. And Jesus attracted a big crowd because his preaching was different. He said, don't worry about what you'll eat, what you'll drink, and what you'll be clothed with. Your heavenly Father knows that you have need of these things. Look at the birds of the air, lilies of the field. Do they toil? Do they spin? What do they do? But your heavenly Father takes care of them. So you don't worry, he says. Don't take a thought. By taking a thought and worrying, you don't change anything. This is the way he taught, and how comforting it is. And thousands of people gathered for Jesus' preaching, and the Pharisaical preaching was religious preaching, and nobody came for it. That's why they were jealous of Jesus all the time. And here, Jesus does it for that very purpose, you see. He made clay out of the out of spitting in the ground and putting it on the man's eye and told him to go and wash in a pool called Siloam, which is a distance away. It is all a violation of the Sabbath. How? Making clay by spitting, working on the ground like this amounts to plowing. They even said to the people, don't look at your face in the mirror, because you may see a gray hair and want to pluck it, that will amount to reaping, you know. These silly books they had written about what is reaping, what is sowing, had laws like this. Just imagine what will happen today if I told you, don't look at the mirror before you come. I don't think anybody will be here, including me, you know. Church will be completely empty. The Pharisaic laws are terrible. And let me remind you, there are some Christian Pharisees also, you know. They teach only rules and regulations. It has nothing to do with the Christian life, you know. So Jesus made the clay and put it on the ground. And I know one guy who came from somewhere abroad and he went to Tinnevelli and made clay by spitting on the ground and put it on some guy's eyes because he couldn't see, you know. I said, why did you do it? He said, because Jesus did it. Well, you got to know why Jesus did it. Jesus did it to upset the Jews there. And the Jews were truly upset because they asked the blind man, who healed you? He said, Jesus of Nazareth healed me. And he's a great man. He's a great prophet. They said, no, he's no prophet. He's not a man of God, because if he was a man of God, he would not have made clay on the ground and put it on your eyes like this. Because it's Sabbath day, he would have observed the Sabbath. He's not a good man. He cannot be a man of God. He said, well, forget it, good man or bad man, all I know is I was blind, now I see. And they were more angry then. So Jesus did some things to upset people, and here also he seems to talk some things in order to provoke some people. You know, sometimes if you can't teach nicely and convey the point, sometimes you got to go to the point of provocation so that you shake them up a little bit so that they listen better and get the point. Certainly they didn't get the point when he made the miracle, bread and fish, and fed them and they were satisfied. They didn't get the point. Now he's shaking them up. So he's using words that are very difficult. He says, the bread I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. Now when they heard that, the Jews, listen to this, they were here again. Anywhere miracle happens, you see they are also there. That's why he does the miracles in that way. The Jews therefore quarreled among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? They said, boy, this guy is teaching cannibalism. He wants us to eat his flesh. Did you hear that? What an erroneous teaching. It's a cultish teaching. He wants us to eat his flesh, they said. Then Jesus said to them, listen to this, most assuredly I say to you, verse 53, unless, now he makes it even harder, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. And then goes on and on until they go crazy, you know. He says, whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them on the last day. He says, I will actually resurrect the person who eats my flesh and drinks my blood. What kind of religion is this? Cannibalism. Eat his flesh and drink his blood and he'll raise you on the last day? They're really upset. Then he says, for my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. You eat and drink my flesh and blood. Gets even worse. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him. And they are growing crazy, I mean. They just don't understand. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who feeds on me will live because of me. The Father sent me, and I live because of him. And he who feeds on me will live because of me, he says. And then he says, this is the bread which came down from heaven. And immediately they remembered manna, which their forefathers ate in the wilderness. This is a bread that has come down from heaven. They're thinking, wow, manna. And then he says, not as your fathers ate the manna and are dead. He says, your fathers ate the manna, sure, but they're dead. No one is alive today. He who eats this bread will live forever. he's really teaching things, making these things very, putting these things in very hard language, purposely. And they are all very upset. What is this eating his flesh and drinking his blood about? Even today some people are upset about this. You know, I remember in the movie Gandhi, you know, they made this famous movie Gandhi. One guy asks a Britisher in the train, he says, in your church, they drink the blood of Jesus, don't they? You know, something like that. He thinks that, you know, that Christians drink the blood of Jesus. In the first 2-3 centuries, there was great persecution against the church because certain lies were spread about the church. They went and told out the world in the church about the church. They said that they spread rumors that said that the Christians are people that eat human flesh and drink human blood. These are horrible people. They practice this thing, and that is how the society hated them. They killed them and heaped them. You know, because they believed that lie, you know. And when they took communion, they kissed each other, you know, because the Apostle Paul says, greet one another with holy kiss, you know. They kissed them, it was a holy kiss. But they went out and said, these are immoral people kissing one another. Like this, they spread news in the world, false, fake news. And because, no WhatsApp in those days, but the mouth is enough. This is pre-WhatsApp days, but mouth is better than WhatsApp, you know. I call it in Tamil, Wayap. They spread the news, and that is the reason why such persecution was there, because of lies that were spread. And look at this kind of talk. What kind of fake news can come out of this? What kind of things can spread out of this kind of talk or teaching that Jesus gave? He deliberately does that to provoke them, so make them think deeply about the point he tries to make about who he is. The whole point about the miracle of feeding the 5,000 was about who he is, and that he is the bread of life and so on. What does he mean when he says, eat my flesh and drink my blood? If you don't eat my flesh, drink my blood, you have no part of me. If you eat my flesh, drink my blood, you live forever. If you eat my flesh and drink my blood, such a person, I will raise him again. What does he mean? He means to say, I'm going to die on the cross. My body is going to be broken on the cross of Calvary. It's going to be beaten and wounded for you. And I'm going to shed my blood. And you better understand why my body will be broken and beaten, and why my blood will be shed. Understand it. Believe that it is for you and for your sins, to remove your sin and your curse. Believe it. Embrace it. Confess it. Meditate on it. Accept it as something that God has done for you. That is how you eat my flesh and drink my blood. He's not talking about eating literally his flesh and drinking literally his blood. He's talking about believing on why his body was broken on the cross, and believing why his blood was shed, and embracing the truth, believing it, confessing it, taking it as yours, that your life, eternal life, comes from it. Believe it like that, he says. And if a person believes like that, he'll be resurrected on the last day. If a person believes like that, he'll live forevermore. If a person believes like that, he will never hunger, never thirst. All of life's hunger and thirst will be taken care of. By faith in Jesus, you'll be fully and totally and eternally satisfied. That is what he's trying to say. What an amazing truth. But they never got the point. They were all upset. Finally, everybody left, and the disciples are also looking at one another, picking up their bags, and they said, let's go. This man has gone crazy. He says he must eat his flesh and drink his blood. And Jesus looked at them and said, are you also going to go? Leave me? And Peter said, no, you have the words of life. Where shall we go? They stayed on. But the thing is this. That is the point that he was trying to make. That they should believe in him. That should believe in the work of the cross that he does there. His broken body and his shed blood, which we celebrated as communion today. We didn't eat any human flesh. We didn't drink any human blood. We ate some bread and wine in remembrance of this very thing that Jesus said, that you eat my flesh and drink my blood. We are saying, I believe that Jesus died for me. His body was broken for me. His body was torn into pieces so that through it eternal life can be received by me. We believe that his blood was shed so that it can wash away my sins. It can cleanse my heart and my conscience and make me whole and clean. That is what we observe today. The communion is about that. We are not doing some kind of a cannibalistic practice. This is something that demonstrates for us vividly the truth that our life, our joy, our peace, our happiness, everything that we have received comes from the death on the cross, that broken body and that blood that was shed. This is all that is, but they never understood. That is why they could not reach out to this truth and grab it and believe it. Why did they come and wanted to follow Jesus? They said, he gave us bread and fish. And he said, don't work or labor for that which perishes. This is just temporal. Bread is just temporal. I am offering you something eternal, something of greater value. Don't try so hard for just the food that perishes, but go for the thing that lasts with you forever and ever. Now, I remember many years ago, one great teacher taught me that in the Bible, there are some clues in to understanding the Bible better. And one of that is, there are statements such as, not this but, you know, that kind of statement. Many statements are made like that. In other words, a truth is stated in the negative and positive form, like it is here in verse 27. Do not strive or do not labor for the food that perishes. That means don't do that. Not this. This is not what I want you to do. But labor for that which lasts for eternity. It is important to state it both ways, because if you just said only labor for food that lasts for eternity, you don't understand it very well. You have to say, do not work for food that flourishes, the food that perishes, but work for food that lasts for all eternity. When you say it both ways, the negative and the positive, it makes much sense. So I explained to you what it means to eat, or what it means to labor for the food that that lasts for eternity. How do you labor for the food that lasts for eternity? Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Come to Him. Repent of your sins. Receive Him as your Lord. Embrace this truth that He died for you. His body was broken. His blood was shed for you. Receive Him and all that He has done on the cross of Calvary as something that is done for you. That is eating and drinking. That is taking for yourself what He has done. That is the way you strive for the food that lasts for eternity. When you pay attention to that, when you meditate upon it, when you learn more and more about it, when you stand on it, when you confess it, when you believe it, when you embrace it, when you take that life as yours, that is eating and drinking. Now let's look at the negative, because the negative is given deliberately here and it helps us. How not to labor for the food that perishes, all right? Now, what does he mean there? Now some people mistake what Jesus is saying here. They think, well, the Bible says don't work for food, don't work for house, don't work for these material things or temporal things. We don't need them at all. No, everybody knows we need them. And they say, well, Bible says, Jesus says, don't work for that. So some people don't believe in working based on this. Now, anytime you read the Bible, you have to read in conjunction with other verses, you know, in relationship to the rest of the Bible. Bible interprets Bible. So let me read you three more verses to show you that Jesus or the Bible never teaches anything against work. It never teaches don't work. And it is wrong to get a salary for your work that you did. And it is wrong to pay your rent with it or buy your food with it, because now then you're working for the thing that perishes. No. The Bible doesn't teach like that. So you got to understand Jesus' words in that way. So let me read to you a few verses, three verses. One is Luke chapter 10, verse 7. Remember the time Jesus sent the disciples to go and preach in various villages, cast out devils, heal the sick, and so on. When they went, he told them, do not take, he said. He said, don't carry money bag, don't carry any knapsack, don't carry any sandals. Don't greet anyone along the road, he says in verse 4. But in verse 5 says, whatever house you enter, first say peace to this house. And if a son of peace is there, your peace will rest on it. If not, it will return to you. If the guy is worthy of peace, he will receive it. Otherwise, it will come back to you, he says. Just go there and stay there, he says. And remain in the same house. Look at verse 7. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking such things as they give. For the laborer is worthy of his wages. Do not go from house to house. A very important statement. He says to the preachers, he says, don't be going from house to house. Stay in that one house. Eat whatever they give you. Drink whatever they give you when you go traveling and preaching from village to village. Why? See, why people go from house to house? It is because they think from going to house, they will get all their needs met, that they will get all that they need to do their ministry. That is how the ministry's needs are met, by going house to house. Jesus said, don't go house to house. They think by going house to house, they will get the food, they will get the clothes, they will get all these things that they need. Jesus said, don't go house to house and don't even take anything with you. Then how are you going to get everything? How are you going to get your food? How are you going to get the money? How are you going to get everything? He says, just stay in that one place, eat what they give you and drink what they give you and just do what I tell you. Don't go house to house, he says. Why? He says, the laborer is worthy of his wages. Why he told them not to take anything? Now some people think Jesus always wants people to go without taking anything. No, the same Jesus later on tells them, last time I told you not to take anything. Later on, I think chapter 18 or so, he says, now take with you, he says. Take everything with you, he says. So this time it was a demonstration of how their needs will be successfully met even if they didn't take anything. So you must read the Bible comprehensively, not just read one verse and think this is the way Jesus operates. No. This is, he's trying to show them what ministry is like, how that God is the one that meets their needs. They should not look to people just going to house and trying to look to people to meet their needs. He says, you go, you do your work, laborers worthy of wages, and God for whom you are working will meet all your need. When they came back, he asked them, were all the needs met? Were you all right? Did you lack anything? You read it. They say, no, we didn't lack anything. Now, if you tell preachers today, a lot of them won't believe that. And I have actually tried that, and I tell you, it works. When I finished my education and all that, I put everything I had in two bags, two suitcases, and one guy had booked me to preach in four places, and I went, and I did not know, thereafter I did not have a place to stay, did not know where I was going after the four events are over, you know, did not know what is going to happen. From that only I became a pastor in a church, from one place to another, one place led to another, and I kept going and preaching for a few months, and then I ended up as a pastor, and as a pastor I got a house, I got a car, I got everything that I needed. And you ask me, will you go without taking anything? I tell you, I did go, and everything was well, nothing was lacking, nothing was left. God didn't forget me, and God will never forget anybody. The laborer is worthy of his labor. God knows that everybody pays a salary, and to God's men, God pays a good salary. There's no doubt about it. Now listen to this. Read 2 Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 10. For even when we were with you, we commanded you this: if anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. I'm trying to show you that the Bible is not against working. The Bible doesn't teach saying don't work. Don't work, everything will be all right. No, that's not what the Bible teaches. It says, if anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. Now what's the problem here among the Thessalonians? Thessalonians were people that concentrated too much on the second coming of Jesus. So some of them said, Jesus may come tonight or tomorrow, any day. He said, soon. So it must be any day. Why bother to go to this interview and get a job and bother to go to work and, you know, and all this business? Forget about this. Jesus may come anytime. So just stay at home, just pray. Prepare yourself, be ready to fly away. That's what the Thessalonians were doing. And Paul says, if anyone is not willing to work, let him not also eat. That is how a strong connection is between eating and working. You got to work. There is nothing wrong in working and eating as a result and so on. So Bible does not teach against working and so on. And the work providing the food and all of that. There's nothing wrong with that. Well, Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. This verse we read a few weeks ago. Let him, verse 28. Let him who stole, steal no longer. But rather let him labor, working with his hands, what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. What is he saying? He says, the guy who steals must not steal anymore, but go to work. Work with his hand, what is good. Choose a good job, go, get a good work to do, and go, decent job, so that you may have something to give that has any need. That means go to work, earn enough for yourself so that you take care of yourself and your own, but then have also enough to give to others who do not have. This is the meaning of biblical prosperity. Why God wants you to have much more than you need? Some people live with this philosophy, me and my two, you know. My wife, me and my wife and my two. You know, if God gives us enough, then we will be satisfied. Well, that is not a very spiritual life. That is a useless life. You know, they say, we don't want anything, we don't want too much. Well, God wants to give too much so that you will have enough to give to those that lack. That's the way the Bible teaches it, you know. And that is the meaning of blessing and prosperity in the Bible. It's given so that you may give, all right? So here it says you must work, not steal. So God is not against working. So the Bible here in John's Gospel is not teaching against working when Jesus said in chapter 6 verse 27 of John, do not labor for food that perishes. He's not saying don't work and have that work pay for your food and all of it. No, that's not the way he's saying. Then what does he mean when he said don't labor for food that perishes? For that you need to open to Matthew's Gospel chapter 6, a verse that everybody knows, but now you'll know it even better. Matthew's Gospel chapter 6 verse 33. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. What does Jesus mean when he said, do not work for temporal things? He means don't just go to work just to feed yourself and buy this and buy that and so on. Seek the kingdom. Are you seeking the kingdom? Am I seeking the kingdom? When we go to work, we must seek the kingdom. What is seeking the kingdom means? Why do we go to work? I don't go to work and you shouldn't go to work because we need to put food on the table and pay the rent. We should go to work because God has a kingdom. In that kingdom, we play a role. God has given us gifts and talents and abilities so that we may use them and produce for the kingdom certain things. God wants us to be productive. God wants us to be useful citizens of this kingdom of God. God wants us to go and do certain things and accomplish certain things to fulfill God's purposes. For that he has made us. He has made us as working people. He has given us gifts and abilities and talents. And he has commissioned us and called us to do certain things. I have a call on my life. Every single one has a call on their life. That is what we taught. So we are made as workers. We are given gifts, bestowed gifts. And we have a call on our lives to accomplish something. And that call always has to do with God's kingdom, God's purposes. We don't live to just eat. We don't live to just have a house. We don't live to just have a few things here and enjoy them and then die. We live for God. So when we go to work, we don't go so that we may have food on the table. We go because God has commissioned us to go, called us to go, given us gifts so that we may go and produce some things that God needs to be produced and done in this world to accomplish things for God in this world. We are God's representative. We go because God's glory must be seen by our work. We go because God's love must be felt in this world through our work. We go because God's purposes must be accomplished. When the Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, it means, are you seeking God's purposes? Are you living for God's purposes? Are you going to work for God's purposes? Are you trying to play your part and do your part in God's kingdom with what God has given to you, the call and the gifts that God has given to you. Hello. Tomorrow when you go to work, remember that. Why are you going? Some people say, well, I got to put food on the table. Otherwise, I won't go to work. Now, you don't understand the Bible at all if you think. That is working for the food that perishes. When you say, I go because I need food on the table. If it was left to me, if somebody gave me the food, and if somebody gave me all the stuff that I have, I would never go to work. That means we don't understand God, we don't understand the Bible, we don't understand Christianity. Even if we had billions and billions, we'll still go to work. And we will work as hard as we've always done, or even harder. Why? Because we are a people made with a purpose. We've been gifted. God has given us gifts. God is going to come back and ask us account of what we have done with it. Have we done our part, played our role in the kingdom of God? Have we done what we are supposed to? Have we gone where he has told us to go? Have we done what he has told us to do? Have we used our talents? Have we been productive? Have we done something useful with what God has done? Have we glorified God? Have we lived it out in such a way that people can see the love of God in this world? God is going to come back and ask us account of that. That is why we go to work. Amen? So, if you go just to put food on the table, then you're working for the food that perishes. But if you go because of the kingdom of God, because of who God is and his great purposes and his call upon your life, and his gifts that he has endowed upon you, and you want to do your part in this kingdom, then you are not working for food. You are working for something of eternal value. Amen? See, I told you, you'll find it out if you dig it. Bible is not contradicting some very simple facts of life. No, Bible is really presenting you a higher ideal, a greater motivation. Only one verse, I'll finish. Turn with me to John's Gospel chapter 4. Remember, Jesus goes to Samaria, and there he meets a Samaritan woman by the well. The disciples who were with him went to buy some food. He's also hungry, so they go to buy some food. And Jesus is waiting there. This woman comes at the well and starts talking to her. And in the end, that woman discovers who this is. This is the Messiah that is to come. She goes and invites the whole town. The whole town now comes and hears Jesus. I mean, by the time they went and got sambar and curd rice, all this is happening. And the disciples come back, and the disciples find him there, and listen to this verse 31. In the meantime, his disciples urged him, saying, Rabbi, eat. They brought food, so they said, Rabbi, eat. He said to them, I have food to eat which you do not know. He says, I have something to eat that you do not know. So they're probably wondering, somebody went and got him something, didn't they? They must have given him something. He must have sent somebody else to get them something. No, he says, therefore the disciples said to one another, has anyone brought him anything to eat? Jesus said to them, my food. See, there's always, they're not able to understand what Jesus is trying to get across. He said, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. He was on duty. He has come for a purpose. He has gone to this village because God is sending him there. He has spoken to the woman because God has led him that way. He has spoken to the entire village because God has led him and guided him. He's doing his work while they're getting food. And he says, when they come back, I already feel like I've eaten because my food is to do the will of the Father. What a man with a vision and a mission in life. He knows exactly what he is here for. He is not working for food. He is not just working for just material needs. He's not working for this and that. He's working to accomplish the will of God. That is my food, he says. And if you think like that, that your food is to do the will of the Father, then you are not working for food. You are working for something of eternal value. And when you do that, Matthew 6:33 becomes reality. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. The Bible doesn't say when you do that, God's will be done and His kingdom will flourish and you will suffer without food. No, it says seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all these things, which things? He's talking about eating, drinking, clothing, and all these things. All these things shall be added unto you. You see, when you live for God and His kingdom, you go busy about His work. You go fulfill your call, use your gifts, use your abilities, work for God. Be a man on mission. I'll tell you, you will never hunger for food. You will have much more than enough because God will bless the work of your hands. You live for the kingdom. And I tell you, that is what true success is all about. And that will bring prosperity on a level that you could never imagine. Amen? Amen? Shall we all stand together? We'll continue next week. Praise God. Remember that tomorrow. Not working for food, working for something of eternal value. For the kingdom. Whatever job you do, you're working for the kingdom, working for God. Because that ability comes from God. Everything that you have, that you use in your work, comes from God. Amen. Father God, we give you thanks today for the truth that we heard. And I pray that this truth will become a real revelation in the hearts and minds of people today. That when they go to work every day and work hard many times, they will remember this, that they are working for you. They're working for the kingdom. They're kingdom employees. They're living for the kingdom, seeking first the kingdom. The thing that matters to them is not their food. The thing that matters to them is what material things that they need or what temporal things that they need. The thing that matters to them is the kingdom. The kingdom of God and His righteousness. The whole purpose rests on God and His purposes. And we know that all these things that we need, the material things, the temporal things, will be added to us in abundance and plenty so that we will never lack anything. We thank you, Lord, and I pray that you will give this perspective as a revelation into the hearts so that our hearts will rejoice as we go to work. And even in spite of challenges and difficulties we face at work, we will rejoice as we do it because the Lord is our helper. He makes difficult things easy for us. He works with us because we are working for Him. And He gives us the strength and the ability and the success and the favor and everything that we need. I pray for success in everything that they put their hand to do, O God. May your blessing rest and abide upon people. In Jesus' name we pray. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with each and every one of us for now and forevermore. Amen.